right, well, the talk tonight, as those of you who received the invitation know, is going to be about true apparitions versus false apparitions. And this is a very important subject matter for us to deal with, especially because apparitions tend to create a lot of commotion, a lot of popularity. And what we have to bear in mind is there are far more false apparitions than there are true apparitions. So hopefully we'll be able to distinguish between the two by the end of this talk, and we'll discuss this. Because obviously false apparitions do not lead to God, do not lead to Our Lady. So to begin this discussion, I just want to say a couple of words about an apparition, a true apparition that I know you all are very familiar with. And it's the apparitions to St. Catherine Laboureil in the Rue de Bac in France, which were the apparitions that gave us the miraculous medal. You all are familiar with the miraculous medal, I'm sure. It's a very beautiful medal. It's a medal that was made to celebrate the Immaculate Conception of Our Lady. This was before the Immaculate Conception was proclaimed. So for that, it is around Our Lady are written the words, O Mary, conceived without sin, Immaculate Conception, pray for us who have recourse to thee. On the back, obviously, you have the Sacred Hearts. You have the initial M and a cross with a base on it that is signifying the Blessed Virgin standing at the foot of the cross. So it's a very beautiful medal. There's nothing controversial about it. But if you read the stories, you find that St. Catherine received the apparitions. There were three apparitions in 1830. Very beautiful apparition. She was in the dormitory. She was a nun sleeping. And her guardian angel came to her and said, Our Lady is waiting for you in the chapel. She went into the chapel and spoke with Our Lady. She knelt down and actually put her hands on Our Lady's lap while she was talking to Our Lady. But what's interesting about this, these apparitions took place in 1830. And the point of the apparitions was Our Lady asked St. Catherine to strike a medal in honor of her Immaculate Conception. Now that seems very innocuous, it doesn't seem like there's anything controversial, but her confessor treated the apparitions with extreme skepticism. So much so, it was two years before the confessor even allowed her to speak to the bishop about her apparitions. The church didn't start investigating the apparitions until 6 years after the beginning of the apparitions, that's in 1836. And the church only gave her final verdict in 1895. So it took 65 years for the church to study and approve the apparitions of the miraculous medal. Obviously, the medal was in wide use already at this point. But hearing this story and hearing how long it took the church to finally give a verdict, a lot of people are very confused. They say, why did it take so long? Why didn't they just approve it right away? And I wanted to give that as an introduction just to show you how carefully the church teaches every apparition and how long it can take to really study an apparition and give final approval. Because this is a very important topic. The church giving approval to an apparition means the church is telling people to get spiritual guidance from that apparition. And she has to be very, very careful. Now, dealing with apparitions, like I said, there are many more false apparitions than there are true. The first thing I want to do is I want to divide false apparitions into two major categories. The first category I'm not going to deal with tonight, and that is the category of hoaxes, of spinsters, people that just want to make money so they pretend that they're seeing something when they're not seeing anything at all. That apparition, there's really not type of false apparition, there's really not much to talk about. You have to use your common sense. It's usually pretty easy to see through. The type that's much more dangerous is when the devil gets involved and promotes visions, apparitions. He can work seeming miracles in order to lead the faithful astray. And that's what I plan on talking about here, mostly. So in order to understand how terrible these false apparitions can be, I want to speak a little bit about Lourdes. Lourdes is one of the most famous apparitions in the world. It has full church approval. Everybody knows the story of Saint Bernadette going there, receiving the visions, the importance of that, all the miracles that have come of that. What most people don't know is all the false apparitions that took place in Lourdes immediately after the apparitions of Our Lady. There was a series of demonic apparitions that took place in order to try and bury the true apparitions of Our Lady of Lourdes so that people wouldn't take Lourdes seriously. So I'm going to go through a little bit and discuss this so you can see how dangerous these false apparitions are. First of all, there was a little bit of a foreboding that the devil was going to be very active at Lourdes, because during the apparitions to Saint Bernadette, during one of the apparitions, Saint Bernadette was walking and she saw a vision of Our Lady. She didn't even know it was Our Lady at this point. And while Our Lady was there, Saint Bernadette heard a demonic voice screaming out, "Get out of here, get out of here." And what's interesting is Our Lady didn't even speak to the devil. It was a demonic voice saying that. She looked in the direction from which the sound was coming briefly, and it was immediately silenced. But it was a little bit of a foreboding of what was going to come, because the devil obviously hates Our Lady very much, and especially the Immaculate Conception of Our Lady. So he was very angry. It was too much for him to take. But that was, like I said, that was kind of the beginning of what would come later. So immediately after the apparitions, a whole string of false apparitions started. In the first case of these false apparitions, five girls together at the grotto saw an apparition. If you look at the people that saw the apparition, the first one was a 22-year-old girl. She was a very pious girl. We have no reason to suspect that she was into anything bad. And she was the first one to see another apparition at the grotto. And this is the way she describes it. "I saw a white stone, and at almost the same time the shape of a woman of normal height supporting a child on her left arm. Her face was smiling, her curly hair fell to her shoulders, and her head was something white, held in place by a sort of comb, then a white dress. As for the child, I did not see him very clearly the first time, and I didn't see him at all in later apparitions." That was one of them. The second visionary at this was a lady who had a very bad reputation. She was an alcoholic. She saw pretty much the same thing. The third lady was a 40-year-old prostitute who supposedly saw Our Lady. The three of them saw pretty much the same thing. They saw this mysterious lady with a child in her arms. I mentioned there were five people. The other two who saw the apparition there were two foreigners that had come to Lourdes. And history has lost track of who they were. It's just registered that there were five. Now, what's interesting, if you start to analyze this, you start to see very strange things about these other apparitions that were taking place. The first thing that's very strange is the site, where they took place. Because the demonic apparitions would not appear in the grotto exactly where Our Lady appeared. On the other side of the cave, right above the altar that had been set up, there was a little hole, a little cave going deeper within the wall of the rock. It was 9 feet off the ground, and it was very small, and it went back some 15 or 16 feet into the rock. It was inside this little cavern that all of the later apparitions were seen, or the first round, I should say, of the later apparitions were seen. And what's very, very strange about this is that the seers that saw these demonic apparitions, they had no ladder with them. It was 9 feet off the ground, and they had no way of getting up there. So what they did was they stepped on top of the altar in order to get inside this tunnel. Obviously, that's something very sacrilegious, and there's no way Our Lady would ask people to do something sacrilegious. So right off the bat, we see some very strange things going on. Also, it's very indecent for ladies wearing dresses to climb up into a rock and crawl down into it. It was very, very strange. But after this first one, various people that were coming to the apparition site started seeing other things. One young girl who was 15, her name was Josephine Albarillo. She, when she saw her vision, became extremely agitated. She started to cry. And she was so in such a nervous state afterwards, they had to take her home and put her to bed. And she says that she was haunted by the apparition for weeks to come afterwards. It was a haunting experience. I'm going to read for you what she saw here. This was reported by a priest that was investigating all these things. The priest writes, his name was Abbe Penn, for what it's worth. She claimed that she had seen a group of three persons in the grotto, a man with a white beard, a fairly young woman, and a child. The old man had a bunch of keys in one hand, and with the other was twisting his mustache. It was first said in the town that it might be the Holy Family. The same vision reappeared later with the addition that the same persons had indulged in indecent gestures. Neither I nor my sister were able to establish whether these gestures had been observed by the same visionary or by others who had the same vision. The girl, however, was my penitent and often told me the same story, to which I paid little attention, considering that it was nothing but a trick of the devil. So these false apparitions start to grow. They start to gain a lot of traction with people. What's interesting, though, is for an astute observer, they could always tell the difference between Saint Bernadette and the false apparitions. A local woman who was very level-minded, her name was Antoinette Garros. She said this, quote, "I had no faith in the other visions. They had neither the faith nor the gestures of Bernadette." This same lady describes that one of the false visionaries tried to throw herself in the river while she was seeing a vision. And she went over and grabbed her to stop her. She would have drowned in the river. And all the people around complained, saying that Our Lady was going to work another miracle. But she said, I wasn't going to let this girl drown just to be able to, you know, see another supposed miracle. So she didn't believe it. Well, in the end, when all of these happenings were finished, there were over 30 recognized people, name, witnessed, testimony given, that had seen visions in the Grotto of Lourdes. Now, Father Cross was one of the first documenters. He was one of the first investigators of Lourdes, and he wrote about this because he investigated all these false ones. It was his opinion that 30, the number of people who claimed and gave testimony, was much, much smaller than the real number of people who received these so-called visions. Because after a certain time, it was so commonplace that nobody was reporting it anymore. It seems very likely that these false visionaries were over 100, more than 100. It was a barrage of false visions. And they started doing very misleading things, very crazy things. One of the things that the false visionaries would do is they'd arrive at the grotto in Lourdes, and they'd take all the flower bouquets, and they'd take the lilies and the roses out and throw them in the river, saying, Our Lady doesn't like lilies and roses. Very strange, strange things. What's interesting is all of these false apparitions came from every age group. Boys and girls, men, women, came from every social level. It was everyone. Now, as I've mentioned, there were some very strange things that allowed us to identify that these were false visions. Another thing was, several of the visionaries would always ask for rosaries, but they insisted that the rosaries were not blessed. And they would hold up the rosaries at hand length like this. They started doing very strange things. At one of these false visions, one of the visionaries turned to the crowd and said, I want you all to start praying the rosary because our Lord is going to pray the rosary with us. Does that strike anyone as strange? Obviously, our Lord is God, and he doesn't pray to the Blessed Virgin Mary. The Blessed Virgin prays to him, obviously. So all these weird things, they started saying that they would bless the people's rosaries instead of having the priest bless it, something Our Lady obviously would never do. And another thing is, these false visionaries would have terrible looks on their face. They would have grimaces. Many times they would make very strange noises during it. One of the young men who was so-called receiving visions would gnash and grind his teeth. He would go into convulsions. He would have a wild look on his face. a lady described one of these boys' apparitions like this, quote, "Once I was present when the boy was having a vision. He was braying," that's the noise that a donkey makes, "and his face was so terrible I couldn't even bear to look at it." Another boy from another town who was seeing visions was up in an attic, and he was looking down on the town square, and he saw his apparition walking in the town square, so he threw himself out the window. This was in an attic, it was at least three stories high, landed on his feet and ran across the square, going after it. So we're seeing all of these crazy things happening, and it's very obvious that these are false apparitions. What was the point of all this? Well, the point of it was, as we've already mentioned, to bury the apparitions of Lourdes, to make people think that everything that was seen at Lourdes, including the true apparitions, were all false. And the prefect, when he saw all these false apparitions, was very much taken with that idea that everything that took place in Lourdes was fake. He said this, quote, "A commission has been nominated to verify the miracle of Lourdes. It is hoped by performing this, performing its task conscientiously and without prejudice, the commission may put an end to this whole wretched business." He no longer believed in anything happening there. He wanted to put an end to the whole business. Another monk who was there, a brother who used to teach in the local school, said the same thing. He said, "I treated everything as a joke, and I began seriously to doubt the value of Bernadette's visions, at which I had never been present." So people who saw both visions, they had a certain way of judging one from the other, but the people who didn't see it, they wanted to throw the whole thing out. They thought it was fake. So because of these false visions, the true apparitions of Lourdes were almost lost to history. So that gives you a little bit of an idea of how much harm these false visions can do. Now, I started out with a vision that was very obviously false. And the devil wanted it to be obviously false so that he could claim or try to influence people to believe that the true visions of Lourdes were false. Not all apparitions are so obviously false. And as a second example, I want to tell you the story of a nun who lived in the 15th century. Her name was Sister Magdalena of the Cross. Has anyone heard of her? Nobody's heard of her now. She was born in Spain, actually in Cordova, in 1487. And during her lifetime, she was a contemporary of St. Teresa of Avila. Not even St. Teresa of Avila was as famous in Spain as she was. She was so famous that Charles V, the Holy Roman Emperor, when Philip II, his son, was born, obviously Philip II is the king of Spain, who the Philippines is named after. When Philip II was born, the emperor, Charles V, had a piece of this lady's habit, her religious habit, cut off and sent to him so he could wrap the young Philip II in the habit of this nun who he considered to be a saint. So let's go through the story of Sister Magdalena. Magdalena received her first vision when she was just 5 years old. She was known in the town for being a pious young girl. And after her fifth birthday, very closely afterwards, she saw a vision of a young man with thick hair. And she said he had a mantle on that was so bright that she couldn't even bear to look at it. It hurt her eyes to look at it. So she received her first vision at this point, and after that, throughout her life, she started receiving one vision after another, after another, after another. It was a constant in her life. And people didn't quite know what to think about these visions at first. But what made things more complicated is very shortly thereafter, she started working miracles. She received one of her visions, and she ran to the church to thank God for the vision she had received. And she saw a cripple man trying to walk up the steps to get into the church. She grabbed his hand to help him up, and he was immediately cured, and he ran through the town saying he had been cured by Magdalena. Very shortly thereafter, a mute person recovered his speech, his gift of speech, through the intercession of Magdalena. Now, when all these miracles took place, the church interrogated young Magdalena to see if there was some strange thing going on, if she was playing tricks, and they found no wrongdoing. They considered it to be supernatural. Well, as Magdalena started to get older, she started doing extraordinary acts of penitence. These reached a height when she tried to crucify herself on the wall of her bedroom. She nailed her feet into the bottom of the wall, and then she nailed one of her hands to the wall. And when she was trying to move around to find a way to nail her other hand, her flesh gave way and she fell on the ground and broke two ribs. She became very sick as a result of this. But every time the doctor would put bandages around her wounds, she'd rip them off because she wanted to do more penance. Now, obviously because of this...
Sorry.
Hi. Please come in. We've just been talking about true versus false apparitions, and I was giving some examples of different false apparitions that have caused problems for the church throughout history. So right now we're talking about the case of a 15th century nun, Sister Magdalena of the Cross. Yeah, she received a lot of false apparitions. So I'm just telling her story right now. So getting back to this, so she tried to crucify herself. She had open wounds. And every time the doctor would bandage them, she'd rip the bandages off. And obviously they all became infected. And the infection spread and it looked like she was going to die. Well, in the midst of her terrible sufferings in bed, one night, I think it was actually Easter morning. Yeah, it was on Easter Sunday. Early in the morning, she jumped out of bed and screamed, and all of her own wounds were perfectly healed. So about this time, it came time for Magdalena to receive her first communion. And she stopped eating 3 months before her first communion, complete fast. She didn't eat anything. On the day of her first communion, when the priest turned around to give her communion, she went into an ecstasy and collapsed on the floor. And a host spontaneously appeared on her tongue. And she told everybody that God himself, our Lord Jesus Christ, had come to give her the host, and she didn't need to receive it from the priest. So after this, you can imagine all of these extraordinary things happening. Her fame started to spread throughout Spain and even beyond Spain. And the miracles started to multiply, one after another after another. She would whip herself until she was bleeding profusely, and by the next day, all of her wounds would be healed. Well, finally, at the age of 17, Magdalena became a nun. She became a Franciscan nun. And when she was in the church professing her vows, another miraculous thing took place. A dove came out of nowhere and flew down and perched on her shoulder and was whispering things in her ear while she was professing. So afterwards, everybody went, because the dove stayed in there for the whole ceremony. Afterwards, the dove flew outside and everybody ran after it, and it flew straight up all the way until it went out of sight, until it disappeared into the sky. So these are extraordinary phenomena. I'm sure everybody would be persuaded these were real visions. The thing went even more. As soon as she became a nun, she stopped eating entirely. She survived only on the Blessed Sacrament. At this point, she started to show other miraculous things. She was aware of everything that was going on in the town and in the country, even though she never left the cloister. At this time, she started also to make prophecies that were coming true. She prophesied that the king would die in the following year, King Ferdinand, and it happened. She prophesied that Cardinal Jimenez Cisneros, who was actually a very, very holy man, she prophesied that he would be the regent, and he was. Actually, Cardinal Cisneros even sent her a beautiful monstrance in recognition of her prophecy that had come true. However, at a certain point, things went on. When Magdalena was 31 years old, a very strange thing happened. very, very strange thing happened. And people started wondering, is this for real or is this not? And what happened was, on the Feast of the Immaculate Conception, 1518, right afterwards, in the evening, she went to the abbess of the convent and she said, I'm pregnant.
What?
She said, I have conceived a child through the power of the Holy Ghost, and it will be the rebirth of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, people really didn't know what to think about this, because it was clear she was in the cloister the whole time. How did she become pregnant? And the child developed as a normal pregnancy throughout 9 months. Now, the nuns in the convent were divided on this. This was a little bit too much for them to take. It seemed a little bit too strange. But they decided to stay silent on it because of her reputation for sanctity was so great. Well, on Christmas Eve, she confirmed that it was time for her to give birth. And her guardian angel told her she had to be alone when she gave birth. So the nuns gave her a little garden house. And Magdalena locked herself up in this garden house for 3 days and came out. She was no longer pregnant. She had a fantastic story to tell. She gave birth at midnight on Christmas Eve, and the child Jesus was shining like the sun, so the whole house was lit up. And in addition to that, the room was miraculously heated so that the child Jesus wouldn't be cold. And something very strange, she claimed that her hair grew to enormous length and turned blonde so that she could use her hair to clothe the child Jesus in. And she said on Christmas Day, the child Jesus disappeared, and she came out. Very strange, but with all of the incredible miracles surrounding her, people still accepted it. Shortly thereafter, she was elected abbess. She became abbess of the convent. She started to demand that the other nuns do severe mortification and very strange penances. If a nun was misbehaving, she would make the nun kneel down and crawl on her hands and feet and make the sign of the cross with her tongue on the shoes of all the other nuns. She took away the whip that the nuns would use to scourge themselves and replaced it with one with iron tips on it, so it would cut into their flesh when they did it. So while she was forcing the nuns to do these extraordinary penances, all of the small penances they were doing, she abolished. She wouldn't let them beg for food, all of these things. She told them to stop fasting on Fridays, which was a tradition in the convent that had existed for centuries, because she said she wanted the nuns to be stronger so they could endure other penances. So all of these strange things go on and on and on and on and on. At this time, she also supposedly received a vision from St. Francis of Assisi, who told her that she was so holy she didn't sin anymore, so she didn't have to go to confession. And together with that, yes, the devil would say that. Now, together with that, she said that a dead person, I guess presumably someone from purgatory, had come to her at night and made a confession to her, had confessed his sins to her. So she encouraged all the nuns to confess to her. She also took the grate out of the confessional, because in a cloistered convent, the priest comes outside the walls and sits, and there's a grating, and the nun comes on the other side and confesses her sins. She ordered that grate be removed, which was a scandal because that was unheard of in Spain, that a priest would hear a woman's confession without a grate in between, especially a nun. But all along, she was receiving praise and admiration from top dignitaries. People were coming to get counsel from her. However, within the convent, where they were seeing all of these strange things happening, she started to lose her grip on the people. The other nuns started to wake up. They started to say, wait, this is very, very strange. So she was reelected twice. When she went to be elected for a fourth term, she lost, and lost dramatically. And another nun became abbess of the convent. And this other nun started to inflict on Magdalena the same penances she had inflicted on the nuns. The first night, she told her that she had to kneel on the floor of their dining room, the refectory, and make the sign of the cross on each tile on the floor with her tongue. And Magdalena started to react very badly to these things. Since she was no longer abbess, she couldn't hide her secrecy very much. One of the other nuns found a box, an iron box under her bed, full of unconsecrated hosts, which was the miracle, the spontaneous communion that she kept receiving. Because that was a miracle that repeated many times. She would kneel in the church and stick her tongue out and a host would appear. They started to feel that she was receiving food clandestinely. Somehow someone was sneaking food to her. So in 1543, she fell gravely ill. Very, very ill. And the abbess suggested that she make a general confession of her whole life. And when this happened, the priest came in, and as soon as he put his stole on, she started going into convulsions. And so for the first time in her life, they started to realize that there was some demonic presence within her. Now, when the confessor saw this, he immediately called a doctor in to examine her to see if there was something physically wrong or if this could really be attributed to the devil. And the doctor came in and she went into ecstasy. And he stuck needles into her flesh, and she didn't react. But when he dipped the needles in holy water before he stuck them in her, she reacted very violently. So one after another, the signs of possession start to come. And one evening, as she was in bed, she heard a loud voice screaming, "You're dying and you won't see another Christmas." And when she heard that, she jumped up and said something very mysterious. She said, "It's 1544. The 40 years have expired. I'm a cursed dog. Take me to hell." So after that, she fell back on her bed and started screaming blasphemies, and she started being lifted up from her bed and thrown back down onto the bed time and time again. It repeated itself many, many times. So at that point, obviously, they realized that she was possessed, and they got a priest to come in and perform an exorcism. When he started the exorcism, the devil, speaking through Magdalena, started laughing and glorying in the trick that he had made in the convent for so many years and how much disorder he had brought into the convent throughout those 40 years. So the Inquisition in Spain at that point came in and they started to investigate the case. They conducted a full exorcism, and Sister Magdalena finally told them the whole story of what had taken place, and it's a really horrible story. She said when she was 5 years old, she did in fact receive a vision, but it was a vision of the devil. And the devil told her, "I will give you fame, and I will give you everything you want if you'll only obey me and do exactly what I say throughout your life." And she accepted that at 5 years old. Mm-hmm. 5 years old. Innocent. You would think she would have been innocent at five, yeah. Exactly. So she goes on and tells the whole story. This started when she was five. She explained how the devil was constantly sneaking her food, how he had taught her how to do a trick to make the host appear on her tongue. He had been the one that had helped her in these supposed ecstasies that she was having. And one of the worst things that took place was when she was a young lady, the devil appeared to her again, and he always appeared in a very attractive form. He was a young man with long black hair, and he appeared in this way. But when he came, she cried out the word Jesus, and he became furious and cast her to the ground. She couldn't move, and he transformed himself into a devil. She explains how horrible. He had horns. He didn't have any teeth in his mouth. He, a horrible, vile beast, and commanded her immediately to become his wife. And she agreed to mystically marry the devil. And that's when the grasp on her really, really, really got bad. Immediately after the marriage ceremony, whatever this union of soul that she had with the devil took place, he appeared again as an attractive young man. Now, what's interesting about that was the devil wanted her to accept him in all his hideousness. And once she had done that, He was willing to again appear attractive to her. So this whole thing took place very beautifully. The exorcism was successful, and she sincerely repented of her sins. She ended up converting. And like I said, the Inquisition was investigating her, and she begged the Inquisition to give her the death penalty. She wanted to be burned for her sins because of everything. She felt that that was a proper punishment for what she had done. But the Inquisition was much more lenient, because the Inquisition said that the devil had started influencing her at such a young, tender age that she didn't have as much responsibility for everything that had taken place. So it's interesting, the penance that the Inquisition gave her. The penance they gave her was she had to walk into the center square of the town with a cord around her neck, a gag in her mouth, and holding a candle as a sign of repentance and a sign that she wouldn't speak out anymore the way she was. And she had to stand in the central square dressed like that for the time it takes for a high mass to be said. So inside the church, they said a high mass, and she was standing out there. After that, she had to recant all her errors in public, which she did, and she was moved to tears when she did. And after that, she had to take the last place in the convent for 3 months, and then she was sent to another convent to live the rest of her life. And for the next 17 years, she did penance, and nobody was able to accuse her of any other faults. So it's got a very beautiful, happy ending. The fact that her name was Magdalena, it's almost like she followed the same story as St. Mary Magdalene, who we know was possessed as well. It says that in the scriptures. But there's a lot of lessons we can draw from this. And a couple of the lessons is, first of all, to realize how tricky the devil can be. He can be an ape of God. He can reproduce miracles and prophecies, all of these things. He has the power to somehow do that. He can't work true miracles, but having an angelic intelligence, he's able to manipulate physical things. He knows the secrets of nature, the secrets of curing, more than any human being ever will know until the end of time. He can accelerate healing processes in bodies. He can do all sorts of things. He's very powerful. So if we see extraordinary things coming from a vision, it doesn't necessarily mean that that vision is true. It's the first thing we have to keep in mind. Another thing that we should keep in mind is all that glitters is not necessarily gold. We see stupendous things happening. It doesn't necessarily mean that we should put faith that extraordinary things are truly happening there. So with this notion, these stories of these false apparitions that come, how tricky they are, we have to be very careful in discerning whether an apparition comes from God or comes from the devil. This is extraordinarily important for us. And it goes in line with what a lot of the saints have said throughout history. The reason this is so important is because the vision we get of Our Lady and Our Lord gives us the model that we imitate, and it affects directly our eternal salvation. If we're misled and we go down the wrong road, we don't know where we could end up. So St. Louis de Montfort was very, very, very adamant about this. If you've read True Devotion, he has a whole section talking about how to discern true devotions from false devotions. And he tells us we have to completely reject false apparitions, false devotions, and accept only the true ones. I'll just read you a little quote of what he said. He said, "Today more than ever, we must take pains in choosing true devotion to our Blessed Lady, because more than ever before, there are false devotions to our Blessed Lady, which are easily mistaken for true ones." So with that in mind, let's start to analyze a little bit the phenomenon of revelation. We're going to talk about this, and afterwards we're going to talk about how you discern one from the other, how you go about understanding which is true and what is not. So if we're talking about revelations, the first thing we have to do is make a distinction, because there are two major types of revelation. There's official revelation, and there's private revelation. Does anybody here know what official revelation is? Official revelation, or public revelation.
That would be the Bible.
Yes, that's part of official revelation, is the Bible. Official revelation is the body of infallible truth that makes up our Catholic faith. It's a very important thing. It is the foundation of our faith. It's all those beliefs that we must accept to be Catholic. Now, official revelation has only two sources. One of them is the Bible, the Scriptures, because the Scriptures are infallible. The other one is the apostolic traditions of the Church. What are the apostolic traditions of the Church? They're the practices, the truths that are not contained in the Bible that have existed within the faith since the time of the apostles. Official revelation ended with the death of the last apostle, and nothing can be added to it. That's very important. The Church reveals and further explains official revelation throughout history, but nothing can be added to it. Because God's revelation to us was whole, it was complete, it doesn't need anything else. So that's official revelation.
Excuse me, you say from the Bible?
The Bible is one source, yes.
The second one?
And the second one is from apostolic tradition.
Oh.
So it's the traditions that have persisted in the faith since the times of the apostles. For example, a perfect example of that is the assumption of the Blessed Virgin Mary into heaven. That's a truth that's not contained in the Bible, but goes back to the time of the apostles, the people who actually witnessed it take place. It goes all the way back to that source, so that is official revelation. Because Christ himself is the only one who brought official revelation to the world. And where that was recorded, where it was in the minds of the apostles and in the scriptures themselves. So that's official revelation. Aside from that, there's private revelation. And private revelation are those revelations made by God to saints and to pious people after the Church was founded. And even when the Church approves of these revelations, it doesn't oblige the faithful to believe in them. It doesn't have the binding force of official revelation. Catholics need to look at private revelations and use their prudence, their wisdom, to try to discern if they're true or not. To help us in this process, the Church does approve of some private revelations. But once again, it doesn't demand that the faithful believe in those apparitions, even the ones that it has approved of. And the reason for that is because divine revelation we believe in through our Catholic faith, through the divine gift of faith. It's called divine faith. And what that means is we can consider that God's authority himself backs up official revelation. Official revelation is as though God is speaking directly to each one of us. Private revelation does not have that same binding force. It's not part of the official revelation. This was set out very well and clearly by a Belgian Jesuit who wrote what's pretty much considered the standard textbook on this. It's called Treatise on Mystical Theology. And the priest's name is Augustin Poulain. And this is what he said, quote, "There are two types of revelations. One is called universal, that's official. It is found in the Bible and in the deposit of apostolic tradition transmitted by the Church. This universal revelation, which ended with the preaching of the apostles, is imposed on all believers. The other revelation is called private. In regards to private revelation made to the saints, the Church does not oblige us to believe in them, even when she approves of them." Pope Benedict XIV explains this with great precision. Quote, "What are we to think of the private revelations that have been approved by the Holy See? For example, those of St. Hildegard, those of St. Bridget, those of St. Catherine of Siena. I say it is not obligatory, nay, is it even possible to give them the assent of Catholic faith?" Remember, Catholic faith we only put in official revelation. We can only put that of human faith, keeping with the rules of prudence, under which they appear probable and worthy of pious belief. So, if there is ever any type of contradiction between official revelation and private revelation, official revelation is true and the private revelation is wrong. It takes total precedence over any private revelation. So, And this is something I can't emphasize enough, because many people put so much faith in private revelations that that becomes their god. It becomes a false idol. I know a lady in Hawaii who, she's an acquaintance of mine, and she told me a terrible story that illustrates exactly what we're talking about here. This woman is a Eucharistic minister, and she brought communion to her dying mother-in-law. But the mother-in-law died before she got there. So she comes with the Blessed Sacrament, and the mother-in-law's dead. There's just a corpse in the room. She received a personal inspiration that told her that she was supposed to put the Blessed Sacrament in the mouth of this corpse. And she did it. Can you imagine the offense to God, putting the Blessed Sacrament in the mouth of a corpse? She knew that the church taught you couldn't do that, but she received this private inspiration. It wasn't even a vision, and she put more faith in her private inspiration than she put in the teachings of the church. That's wrong. You cannot do that. She even went further. She told me, she said, yeah. She said, I went to confession afterwards because I know what the rules are, but I know I didn't do anything wrong. That's called a sacrilegious confession as well. So this is very dangerous. You see how these things can influence us. So with that said, what is the role of private revelation? What's the purpose of these private revelations we see? It has a very beautiful role in the church. It's not that we should despise it. The first thing it does is it contributes to the fervor, the repentance, and the piety of the faithful. A perfect example of this is the private revelations to St. John Bosco. Do you all know who St. John Bosco was?
Yes.
Yeah, he was an Italian saint who lived in Turin,
Italy. Salesian.
Yes, he founded the Salesian Order. Exactly. Exactly. And he was the recipient of many private revelations. His dreams were many times private revelations. And he ran a school for boys, for young boys, many of which were castaways. They were homeless on the streets. And the bulk of his apostolate, his outreach with these young boys, was to tell them the private relations he had received, to recount for them the dreams he had received. He received dreams of heaven, he received dreams of hell, the future of his school, all of these things. And that was the way he sanctified these boys. It's a very important role. In addition to that, many other private revelations have the same goal. They've done the same thing for us. You take Fatima. How many people, how many hundreds of thousands or millions of people have come back to the faith because of the apparitions at Fatima? They strengthen the faith. Guadalupe is another perfect example of this. Many people know about the Tilma, the miraculous Tilma of St. Juan Diego, but few people realize the situation of Mexico when Our Lady of Guadalupe appeared. It was Our Lady of Guadalupe more than any clergyman that converted Mexico. Things were going so badly for the missionaries in Mexico that they were getting ready to leave. The missionaries were fed up. The bishop who was there was even almost assassinated. And the bishop, his name was Zumárraga, Bishop Zumárraga, was so frustrated with the way that they were incapable of converting the natives and fostering a civilization. Very shortly before Guadalupe, this is what he said, and I quote, "If God does not intervene to provide an instant remedy, this land is on the verge of being lost forever," close quote. He saw no human possibility. Our Lady of Guadalupe appeared, and in the next 8 years, 9 million Indians converted. So Our Lady of Guadalupe converted. So this is the role, these are the types of things that private revelations do. Another thing they do is they start new devotions in the church, and they fortify old devotions. Perfect example of this is devotion to the Sacred Heart of Jesus. That was the fruit of private revelation. St. Margaret Mary Alacoque received the visions, and even though afterwards the theologians studied this devotion, devotion to the Sacred Heart, and approved of it entirely, they gave theological reasons of why we should adore the Heart of Jesus. The start of that was a private revelation. In addition to that, devotion to the Holy Face of Jesus. You all are familiar with that devotion. That was the fruit of the revelations to Sister Mary of St. Peter. So you see, there's a very important role that these have. I would like to add a couple of other private, thank you very much, Doctor, a couple of other private revelations that have led to very important devotions in the church. And the most important one is the rosary. In its present form, there was a type of rosary before that, but in its present form, the rosary was given to St. Dominic in the way we pray it. Similarly, Fatima gave us several prayers, one of which was inserted in the rosary. After each decade, we pray, "Oh my Jesus, forgive us our sins." That came from Fatima. That didn't exist before Fatima. So you see, it introduces new devotions. Another thing that is very beautiful about private revelations is many times they confirm doctrines of the church. A perfect example of that is Lourdes again. Because 4 years before the apparition of Lourdes, the church proclaimed the dogma of the Immaculate Conception, that Our Lady was entirely free of original and actual sin throughout her entire life. That was proclaimed in 1854. 4 years later, in 1858, Our Lady appeared at Lourdes and defined herself. When St. Bernadette asked who you are, she said, "I am the Immaculate Conception." So it was kind of a seal of heaven confirming the doctrine of the church. But with that said, what should we not expect from private revelations? These are things we can expect: new devotions, increase of piety, confirmation of church teaching. What should we not expect? First thing we should not expect is changes in church doctrine, changes in belief, changes in the morality of the church. If you see someone, or you know someone who's receiving a vision that says that women should be made priests, you know that's a false vision. Private revelations don't change our belief system. Similarly, if a revelation comes and says all religions are the same, doesn't matter if you're Catholic or not, you know that's a false apparition right off the bat. Because again, you can't have a contradiction between the two. And that is not the point. That is not the function of private revelations. It was very well explained by a very good friend of Pope Pius IX, Cardinal Pietra. He explained the types of things we should not expect from private revelations. And he did it like this. He said, "It is well known that one is entirely to believe or not in private revelations, even those most worthy of credit. When the church approves them, they are received only as being probable and not unquestionable. They should not be used to resolve problems of history, physics, philosophy, or theology that are being disputed at the time." That's not their role. One can distance oneself from these revelations, even those approved by the church, when having solid reasons to do so, and above all, when a contrary doctrine has been established by the church documents and positive experience. So what this is saying is you're free. There's a little bit of a nuance here, because you are free to reject private revelations, even those that were established by the church, but you have to have solid reasons for doing so. I mean, if you deny devotion to the Sacred Heart without good reason, you commit a sin, for sure. But you don't become a heretic. Is that clear? The distinction there? Okay. With all this said, finally, let's get into the rules. What are the rules of discerning true and false apparitions? And before we get into the rules as such, I want to just give some general cautions first. The first thing is we need to look to scriptures and see what our Lord has said about this. And many times he touched on this notion. In St. Matthew's Gospel, he said, quote, "For there shall arise false Christs and false prophets, and they shall perform great signs and wonders, even miracles, or seeming miracles, insomuch as to deceive, if possible, even the elect." St. Paul also warns us in his letter to the Corinthians, Satan transforms himself into an angel of light. We saw that with Sister Magdalena at the cross. Another thing is, we touched on this, but another general caution is miracles, the fulfillment of prophecies, these do not confirm the validity of a private revelation. And the last thing I want to mention is one should be very cautious about any revelation that forces people away from the common way of acting of divine providence. If someone reveals that they have a shortcut, you don't have to pray a rosary anymore, there's a shortcut to heaven, don't believe it. Don't believe it. St. John of the Cross and St. Teresa used to teach that the common road to arrive at sanctity by means of prayer and the practice of virtue have to be recommended to everyone. That is the way of getting holy. Prayer, sacrifice, practice of virtue. Anything that leads you off that trail, you should be very cautious about. So as to the rules themselves, I'm going to use, my main source is going to be a theological work by Father Royal Marin, Antonio Royal Marin, who was a great Spanish theologian. And he wrote a book called The Theology of Christian Perfection. That's what I'm going to take these rules from. The first thing you have to do when there is an apparition is you have to look at the doctrinal content of it. Is this coincide with church teaching? If there's anything that goes against church teaching, you know it's not true. And the way Father Marine says this is, quote, "Any revelation contrary to dogma or morals must be rejected as false because God does not contradict himself. Any revelations contrary to the common teaching of theologians or purporting to settle an argument among schools of theology is gravely suspect." So if two schools are studying whether or not Our Lady is the universal mediatrix of graces, and a private revelation comes up and says, "I am, tell the doctors that I am I am the co-redemptrix." Mm-hmm. You have to be suspect of that. Why? Why would you be suspect of that? It seems kind of strange at first, but the reason you should be suspect is because those doctrines have to be based on official revelation. Remember we were talking about that? They have to be based on the body of what Christ himself told us when he was on this earth, which is revealed to us through the scriptures and apostolic tradition. That's the source, not private revelation. So private revelation would be inverting the order of things. Yeah. Does that make sense?
So the devil actually uses the private revelation to get his way.
What's that? The devil? Yes, exactly. The devil uses private revelation when it's a false one to accomplish what he wants. The second rule is as to the way the revelation is given. I'm going to read to you what Father Marine says and then we'll talk about it. "Revelations concerning merely curious or useless matters should be rejected as not divine. I've heard of some apparitions where a lady comes down and says, 'Oh, you have a beautiful dress on today,' and they chit-chat. That's not real. Curious or useless matters. Our Lady's not going to come down from heaven to tell you you've got nice clothes. It's not going to happen. The same is to be said of those which are detailed, lengthy, and filled with superfluity and of proofs and reasons. Divine revelations are generally brief, clear, and precise." You see these apparitions where Our Lady appears to someone 20,000 times. Our Lady couldn't say what she had to say in less than that? That's immediately a red flag that goes up. If you think about the real apparitions, Our Lady came to Fatima how many times?
Six.
Six short apparitions. The miraculous medal, three short apparitions. Mm-hmm. Our Lady's concise. She doesn't go on and on and on and on and on. The next thing, actually, it's funny. I'm sorry to talk about someone else, but there's a lady in Hawaii who was talking to a friend of ours, and she came to the friend of ours one day and said, "Look, when I was in the shower this morning, Our Lady appeared to me, and she told me that you're phony, and you don't really love God, all you want to do is promote yourself." That would be something that I think, Our Lady doesn't appear to you in the shower, she doesn't say something like that. I mean, it's just totally wacko. But you see this all the time. It happens everywhere. Next thing you have to analyze is the seer themselves, the visionary, because sometimes people have nervous problems that can make them think they're seeing things when they're not. Father Marine says this, the person who receives the revelation should be examined carefully, especially as to their temperament and their character. If the person is humble, well-balanced, discreet, evidently advanced in virtue, and enjoys good mental and physical health, there is good reason to proceed further and to examine the revelation itself. But if the individual is exhausted with excessive mortification, suffers from a nervous affliction, is subject to periods of great exhaustion or great depression, or, and this is a very interesting one, is very eager to divulge their revelation, there is cause for serious doubt. True visionaries aren't dying to tell you what Our Lady told them. They're humble. They're suspicious of themselves. Many times when we're doing our Fatima visits with the statue, you arrive at a house and there's someone there that's just dying to tell you of the apparition they've received that day, tell you what you're supposed to do. You feel like saying, well, excuse me, if you're seeing Our Lady every day, why do you want to come and pray before the statue? Why am I bringing the statue here? Just pray before Our Lady. You see what I'm saying? It doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense. There's another lady in Hawaii. I'm sorry to keep trashing on people in Hawaii. There are really good people in Hawaii, too. But it's another example. Just the last time I was in Hawaii, it was actually the same lady that put the Blessed Sacrament in the mouth of her dead mother-in-law. She came to me after church when I was making my Thanksgiving and told me she had to tell me about an inspiration she had. And her inspiration was that she was supposed to go to the governor of Hawaii and basically convert him. Governor of Hawaii, Governor Abercrombie, is literally a communist. He's pro-abortion. He's pro-homosexual marriage. He was going to convert him. And so I was trying to get her to think a little, but I said, so-and-so, I said, you have to think if that's really going to accomplish anything. And when I said that, she became furious with me. And she said, I don't want your advice. Your place is to sit there, listen, and obey. That's the lady that's very eager to take the authority of Our Lady into her own hands. Does everybody understand that?
Yeah.
Good, good.
Not humble.
Not humble, very good. The last thing for discerning is, once again, I've said this twice, I'm not going to belabor the point, but the fulfillment of prophecies and extraordinary miracles does not confirm an apparition. It does not. The devil can make use of natural means to know things that it seems impossible for people to know. Perfect example of that is Nostradamus. We all know Nostradamus made extraordinary predictions about the future, many of which came true. That doesn't mean he was receiving visions from God. The devil can't see the future, but the devil can manipulate the future, and he also knows all of the true prophecies of the church from the very beginning. And he knows how to interpret those. He can piggyback on true revelations, true prophecies, and make it look like he's the origin of it. So with that said, I'm going to move on to the conclusion right now. And the conclusion is basically a final word. How is it that we should approach these private revelations that come up? And in approaching this, you have to fight against two tendencies that we all have, two bad tendencies. The first tendency is systematic disbelief, where any type of vision, you don't believe in it. To deny the possibility of apparitions and private revelations is to deny the possibility of God performing a miracle. There's too much evidence. God can do these things, and he does them. We can't just write off any private revelation. The second extreme that we have to avoid is uncritical belief. That every visionary that comes around, everybody who sees Our Lady in a grilled cheese sandwich, all of a sudden we accept that they're... That happened. That happened. I'm not making that up. You all remember that case probably. We can't just believe someone because they say they're receiving visions. And remember that false apparitions are much more likely, much more common than true apparitions. So basically what I'm trying to say is that in this case, virtue lies in the middle. You can't be overly believing in every apparition that comes along, but you can't deny the possibility and deny every apparition that comes along. You have to use your wisdom and discernment to try to figure out which are the true apparitions and which are the false apparitions. And above all, have confidence in what the church says about these apparitions. The church has means, the church has wisdom, the church has developed ways through 2,000 years of the most brilliant men in the world figuring out how you discern one from the other. If the church approves of an apparition, you have to give that precedence over an apparition that the church has not approved. Does that make sense? Always give a preferential option for the apparitions or revelations that are approved by the church, and reject those apparitions that have been condemned by the church. That's the way you should act. So just as a final summary, you know, we live in very troubled times, very difficult times, and that makes us very needful of private revelation. And we need to give our hearts very much to the real private revelations that come, because they come to strengthen us. Perfect example is Fatima. When Our Lady said at Fatima, "Finally my Immaculate Heart will triumph. Russia will convert and an era of peace will be granted to the world," we should be inspired by that. We have to become very inspired with that and draw confidence, increase our confidence in God, confidence that better times are on the horizon. But always being mindful that troubled times lead to true apparitions. They make it also much more easy for false apparitions to show their head, because people are desperate. They're looking for something to cling to. So that's pretty much what I had to say to you all. I don't know if anyone has any questions or comments before we get dinner.
I would like to ask you a question. Who approves, you know, the apparition?
The apparition, when an apparition takes place, the first person responsible for investigating it is the local bishop. The local bishop goes, he starts investigating it. If he wants to go further than that, or if the faithful want it to go further than that, the investigation of the bishop is sent to Rome, to the Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith. And they analyze it, they study everything very, very carefully, and they're the ones that judge the final word on it. Anyone else have anything?
Is there it was on a canonization possibility or something. The cost, it costs the church something to investigate. And I've heard it can run to quite some cost. As far as
I can imagine.
It either doesn't happen, or it takes a great many years before we find out.
Yes.
Simply because of the cost.
Yes. So during that process, in which the church is studying an apparition and hasn't given a verdict, you're free to believe in it or not. But like I said, you should always give precedence to the ones that have been approved, because they've gone through the rigorous study. We can have confidence that those aren't coming from the devil. So, is there anything else? Yes, Mrs. Kusel? Oh, sorry.
I have a question, okay. You know that Divine Mercy, devotion?
Mm-hmm.
And lately I've been receiving comment that it was not approved by the church, like Fatima.
Yeah. That's very, very complicated. And the reason it's complicated is when those apparitions first came out, Pope Pius XII condemned them. Now, John Paul II opened up the case again and approved of them. And he said that Pope Pius XII didn't have very good translations of the material, so he didn't have all the means to judge properly. So that's the full story on St. Faustina and the Divine Mercy revelations.
What about the rosary, the luminous rosary?
That had nothing to do with private revelations. That was just the Pope instituting it.
So it's clear that it's approved by the church,
Yeah,
right?
John Paul II approved it, yes. And also, whenever someone who receives visions is canonized, that gives a certain more credulity to the visions. But it doesn't mean either that it's approved by the church. Because a saint can be deceived by the devil just like anyone else can be. So with that, maybe we can finish.